Anyone who claims to be the inventor of Bitcoin is lying.
Some people will believe, some people won't. And to tell you the truth, I don't really care.
Maybe I should rephrase that. There have been some that claim to be the inventor of Bitcoin, but they're not.
I don't want money, I don't want fame, I don't want adoration.
They're absolutely, positively not the inventor of Bitcoin.
To me, this brings back Phil Zimmermann, who's the guy that originally wrote Pretty Good Privacy, which was the mother of all crypto inventions. So he took this work from academia and from the military, turned it into this package that offered military-grade encryption for civilian email, and basically fired the first shot in this kind of 20-year cypherpunk war. And, you know, Zimmermann fought like hell for about 5 years with the US government. They used to have to take the source code of PGP, print it out into books, export the books, and then scan it again to get through a technical loophole with the US law about banning the export of cryptography software. But it was no longer considered software if it was in the form of a book. And, you know, the fact that the government was willing to go to these extraordinary lengths to try and control cryptography was an indicator that cryptography was fundamentally important. And here we are now, 20 years later, we're up to our eyeballs in the Snowden problem.
With the growth of the internet, it became necessary for everyone to have access to strong encryption. Cryptography is the art of scrambling information to make it unintelligible, except to those that have the right key to unscramble it. So governments form their opinion about cryptography as a consequence of how pivotal it was to the outcome of World War II. The government regarded it as a munition and restricted its export. Everybody is so excited about blockchain that they kind of lose their minds. If you have a bicycle shop and you rename the bicycle shop the blockchain bicycle shop, then your stock goes up in price. The killer app for blockchain is cryptocurrencies. When you combine blockchain with proof of work, you get Bitcoin. The cypherpunks, a group of activists in the San Francisco Bay Area, were quite interested in promoting strong encryption. I like the idea of writing software and releasing it, and the software changes the facts on the ground. It's politically easier to bring about these changes if the software is already deployed. It makes it harder to make the software illegal if it's available everywhere.
The world of finance is extremely jealous of its territory. As soon as they see a version of finance popping up, even if it's just a little internet toy payment system, they get rather aggressive. Phone calls are made. The central bank is annoyed, the FSA is annoyed, the various regulators are annoyed, and they are pushed to do something about it. In the late 90s, after DigiCash, there were a lot of different ventures starting up and getting into the business, and a lot of them failed, partly because they got no support from the finance people. One particularly famous system was Eagle. E-Gold started up in about 97, doing gold on the internet, and built up its base up until about 2000 or so, when it started to become profitable and started moving forward. Unfortunately, E-Gold got into trouble, came to the attention of the feds, and the feds walked in there with weapons, SWAT team and so forth, and took them down. After a period of 2 years worth of court cases, the whole thing was basically rolled over, and although E-Gold was still running, huge numbers of accounts had been seized, nobody particularly trusted it, and nobody particularly trusted the result. In essence, it was shut down.
Getting rid of a network's a different matter than your hard drive failing or a subpoena against a server.
The problem with our classical view of payment systems, Alice pays Bob but goes through Ivan, a server, is that somebody, it doesn't have to be the state, it can be anybody, can attack the server and shut it down. or steal money, or et cetera, et cetera.
Because we couldn't do decentralized currencies, we did centralized ones.
And here's where Satoshi Nakamoto had his, shall we say, his genius stroke. Let's not use some sort of heuristic. Let's not use some sort of algorithm. Let's not use some sort of hierarchy. Let's do a lottery. Let's create a lottery. We don't care which of the transactions goes forward, as long as it's only one of them.
Well, I've been calling myself a decentralist, which is this notion of preventing anyone from having so much power.
We don't really care anymore which transaction was accepted. We only care who's got the biggest number. And that is something that we can guarantee cannot be spoofed, cannot be attacked. Because the calculation of the hash, the proof of work thing, is this magical cryptographic blah, blah, blah.
Not depending on traditional cryptographic security, but really depending on economic incentives to encourage good behavior. And as long as they work on a macro scale, the whole system remains secure and has this distributed consensus property.
So if I give it an input, which is different, I cannot create that big number without going through massive amounts of processing. Everybody is therefore on the same footing. It is therefore a lottery, a fair lottery across all of the machines. One person gets to win the lottery, they get paid their 25 bitcoins for that. And that person is the one who chooses which transaction goes through, and therefore we've solved the double spending problem.
Messages are sent on a best effort basis. Nodes can leave and rejoin the network at will whilst trusting the longest proof of work chain whilst they were gone. This is all about what happens when we turn our backs on the system.
Here's the difference. If we had a 51% solution in an election, like in a democratic election for a political party, that 51% would be able to temporarily, in a democracy without any other checks and balances, seize control of the governing body and make changes. What changes could they make? A coup would go too far, so they would probably be subtle changes, but in most democracies, those changes would reverberate through 4 years of governance until they get kicked out. Well, in Bitcoin terms, that's 10 minutes. And in those 10 minutes, all they can do is double spend a few transactions. The broader issue would be if you had a sustained 51% attack whose primary motivation would be to change the core protocol, essentially pull a coup on Bitcoin by changing the mechanics of the core protocol. In order to do that, you would not only need a 51% attack, but you would have to make that coincide with an upgrade of the system so that the majority chain actually moved to a different version of the protocol or to a different version of the software. That scenario is impossible. And the reason it's impossible is because it's not just the miners who have part in the consensus system, especially when we're talking about protocol changes. The miners can affect what is the longest block. But in order to affect which is the prevailing software choice, they have to persuade the users to change, and they have to persuade the web wallets that represent millions of users to change, and they have to persuade the merchants to change. If the miners were to take the protocol in the direction that the users don't want to go to, they would find themselves on the majority chain, but they would find themselves on a majority chain empty of transactions, because all the users would stay behind. A minority chain with actual transactions and merchants is the majority chain, because that's where the value is. And so you can't really hijack Bitcoin the software and Bitcoin the algorithm or any cryptocurrency with a 51% attack long-term in a coup, because you would lack the consent of the user wallets and the web wallets and the merchants who wouldn't follow you down that path because it would be obvious.